Good morning, everyone. I thank PDA for inviting me again. I'm really happy to be here and talk to you about a culture of quality and the progress we have been making at FDA since the last time we spoke collectively here. As you know, we're going through at FDA a fair series of changes, and many of these are really intended to try to help shift through regulation the industry to kind of where Marina is actually, and Lily is, which is to move toward a culture of quality that's owned by the firms and actually is achieved with, as you've heard us say before, with really minimal federal oversight. Not that we're going to go away. So as background, just this is something you all know, but let me walk through this a little bit. The pharmaceutical manufacturing landscape has really changed over the past decades and is continuing to evolve rather quickly. FDA's regulatory approach is also going to have to evolve to keep up. And some of the most significant changes include the massive shift from domestic to overseas manufacturing sites, which has affected all of you as well as the FDA, rise in contract manufacturing, the fragmentation of stages of manufacturing, not only by ownership, but also by geography and diversification of suppliers. The sheer volume increase, sometimes we forget about this, but I'm a physician, and I recognize that medicine now is the mainstay of healthcare, and there's so many more medicines. And there's so many of our citizens in this country and around the world are depending on those medicines every day to stay alive, to stay healthy, and so forth, to treat serious illnesses. And even when I took over in CDER in 1994, the amount of medicines that are now available has increased tremendously. And the reliance of the healthcare system upon those medicines has also increased. That's why we're getting such tremendous anguish. I met with a health professional group yesterday, and the drug shortages are, they're just appalled and angry about those drug shortages because they rely on those medicines to treat their patients. This set of changes, and the corporate headquarters too, have moved all around the world, and maybe are going to be moving more if we believe the news reports. But in contrast to these business arrangements that have really changed a great deal, the manufacturing and science and technology has evolved much slower than other industrial sectors. So here we have a industry that's pretty stressed by being all around the world and being so complex and fragmented, and yet the technologies that we're using would be recognizable in many cases by people doing this job 40 years ago. Now, the recent generic drug user fee arrangements reflect some of the changes that we're seeing. It calls for inspectional parity, for example, as one of the major requirements, inspectional parity by the end of the program between U.S. and outside the U.S. sites. So FDA has to achieve in some way equal scrutiny of any site, wherever it is around the world, if they're marketing a drug for the U.S., a generic drug. And it's really the first drug user fee program to encompass GMP surveillance inspections. So I think this is really a landmark. And now we have, of course, compounding at FDA is added onto this drug compounding in a complex regulatory system that we have to put in place there. So I would say, the people who are from FDA here know this, I think that FDA has not responded to all these changes as speedily, at least as I would like. Apparently, it takes a big effort to move an ocean liner and get it going in another direction. In early 2000s, when I was working in the commissioner's office, we had the Pharmaceutical Quality for the 21st Century Initiative, which brought about a number of changes. We got the ICH guidances, Q89 and so forth. And we with the industry, stimulated the use of process analytical technologies or at-line and online monitoring and so forth. We put forth initiatives on quality by design that were mainly really intended for industry to have better process and product knowledge. And we formed a pharmaceutical inspectorate within ORA, the field organization, that was supposed to specialize. But these improvements, although they were significant, I think they laid the groundwork for the changes that we needed to do, did not go all the way to their logical outcomes. We made small incremental changes, but we didn't do what we needed to do. So we're undertaking this now at CDER and at ORA beside us. And the generic drug user fee program really provides both the impetus and an additional funding. And in fact, we're going to have to change rapidly to fulfill all our GDUFA commitments. But we need to change in the direction that we've been planning to move in all this time and that we started back in 2004. So what changes are contemplated? Well, we continue to be dedicated to our vision, which we articulated then, of bringing about through our regulatory structure a flexible, agile pharmaceutical manufacturing sector that reliably produces high-quality medicines without extensive regulatory oversight. And we are continuing to that. And I think you heard from Maria, you know, how that can be done, right? And of course, that's what the culture of quality, that's really a lot of the subject of this meeting, that's what this is all about, all right, is an industry ownership without extensive regulatory oversight of producing those high quality products and of continuous improvement. Now, experience from other manufacturing sectors tells us that the best and probably the only way to reliably achieve high quality production is to have everyone involved in that production, from the shop floor to the CEO, be pretty fanatically committed to it at all times. That's what we've learned over and over again in multiple industries. And to it is to quality, to high quality, not to compliance. And that may sound like heresy of somebody from FDA standing up here saying this, but you need a culture that focuses on learning from mistakes, not one that tries to sweep them under the rug out of fear of the consequences. A culture of compliance means you're trying to meet somebody else's expectations. A culture of quality means you're trying to meet your own expectations. There's a fundamental difference there. A culture of compliance actually is not the most successful, and if you talk to all the quality gurus and all the quality institutes, they have a culture of compliance as a step along the journey, but an early step, okay, where people are sort of beaten into submission rather than leading the charge, right? So what can FDA do to facilitate this? You may well think this could be empty words if, in fact, we don't deliver on changes that actually help bring this desired state about. Now, we can't, under our statutory framework, mandate, and obviously, since we don't work in companies, we can't create a culture of quality. If a firm gets an acceptable product out the door, but has long cycle times, high inventories, high waste, and poor process capability, it doesn't violate our regs, right? If it doesn't violate our regs, then we don't do anything. But we know from sad experience that this kind of scenario, where all these things are in play, eventually leads to a series of mistakes over space and over time that result in substandard product getting out the door, right? And then recalls and possible patient harm and then possible regulatory action. But the problem with that scenario, it's all after the fact. Instead of building that quality in, it's, okay, we made a series of mistakes, now what's gonna happen? A warning letter or a regulatory action or whatever. A culture of quality is all making sure that anything goes out the door you can be proud of. So what FDA can do is organize our regulatory approach to both foster that culture of quality, right, while also detecting and intervening in instances where there's a potential for substandard product and human harm. Because not everybody is going to go on this journey at the same rate, or even get on the first steps of the journey, to be quite frank. There's always going to be a range. We intend to focus less on the details of how industry does its work and more on the results of what have you achieved at the end of the day. So let me move to the steps we're taking, because we're in the middle of making all these changes now. At CDER, we're changing the way we do pre-market review. And you might say, well, what does that have to do with? Well, that has a lot to do with what happens afterward, what we think. And the important changes include we're going to do expertise-based team reviews. So it'll be a whole team across the production of the product. And we plan to include the inspectors on the team. So if people go out and inspect, they'll be part of the assessment team. And we're going to do an initial risk assessment of the drug substance, the drug product, and the processes that make them. And that risk is supposed to focus on clinically relevant parameters, not necessarily process-based. So we have already started our effort on clinically based specifications. Now, some of you in this room may be hearing this. I don't believe this is going to happen. But we are well along in this journey, and we're doing pilots on the team review right now. We have agreements with ORA in the field on how we're going to do the inspections. We're getting them onto our IT system. We hope to stand up our new pharmaceutical quality platform that'll have all the data October 1, because I think, Maria, one of the principles is everybody should have access to all the information. You can't have this team over here blind to whatever this group has discovered. So one of our mantras is that everyone has access to all information on the assessment team, and that means the field has to get onto it. We have to get onto their systems, and they have to get onto our systems. And we're going to incorporate our lab staff. We have a wonderful analytical laboratory at CDER in St. Louis, and our formulation lab, which consists of complete experts in drug formulation, into the review process where appropriate, so that we have real experts where needed. And our mantra is one quality voice, okay? Which means that a single quality assessment will be carried out in any application, whether it's a new NDA, an ANDA, or a supplement, manufacturing supplement. We will incorporate the information about the facility as well as the product information into one quality assessment. And we plan to give that to all our customers, our OGD customers, our new drug customers, and to the industry, so that you'll hear about the quality assessment that we have made. That hopefully will bring together all the relevant factors that go into the quality of a product. Now, to facilitate this, we're also working on an ambitious project with the field organization to revise make new templates for both pre-market inspection and surveillance inspection. And we want these to be more of an assessment so that it goes through the good side. Okay, if you're doing a great job, we want to record that, and less of a finding individual violations. Now, of course, if an inspector wants to give observations to the firm, that's wonderful. That's part of a free flow of ideas. But what we want to end up with is an understanding of the state of quality within that facility and within the various product lines or a product line, if it's a pre-market assessment. How likely is it that this firm will be able to produce a high-quality product when they're at commercial production? That's really what we want to know. So obviously, you know, if the firm has a very strong quality management system, they will be able to do that, because they won't ship substandard product out the door, right? But that's an intangible thing. I hope that's what you're going to talk about at this meeting. How do you assess that culture of quality? How do you know it's really, with all the commercial pressures you're under, with all the different problems, with all the scientific uncertainty, how do you know, how can we know and be confident that you will stand in, you know, impartial way, more or less, and say, no, this won't cut it if something is wrong? Because that's kind of, that's the courage part of the C's, I think. Now, we're also in the process of forming our surveillance office. And surveillance is the term we're giving to what we do after for marketed products that are made all around the globe, as I said, and shipped all over the place and everything. We're setting up a surveillance system to understand them. I think I'm assured by my staff that we finally have an inventory that we can believe of who makes the products, where they made, and so forth. And that's part of our pharmaceutical quality platform. But then we can attach to that all the intel we have, you know, what amendments have been made, what inspections from US FDA, from other regulators have been done, what have been their findings, and so forth, so that we hope to get a much better understanding through this type of surveillance function, even before we go out and do inspection of what the state of the industry is. As I said, we're standing up version 1.0, which is probably going to be fraught with some difficulties, as these ambitious projects usually are on October 1. We're keeping our fingers crossed. So the use of IT, I think, is essential here, and I think for any modern quality system, it's one of the fundamentals. You've heard repeatedly, and PDA has been assessing, helping us assess what we're doing about metrics. We'd like to attach to this inventory some metrics, just like you heard from Maria, that, and we've heard from many firms that they keep a dashboard to look at how their facilities are doing, and so they understand. And we'd like to have leading indicators. We wouldn't like to just hear about things that went wrong, because that is a little bit too late for the kind of preemptive action we think you and we should take. That project is going quite well, and you'll be hearing from us, and we thank all the different people who've participated in this, have sent us candidate measures. And we have asked for and are considering some measures of the culture, the quality culture within the organization. A much more intangible and different thing, but probably the most essential as far as predicting performance over the, which is what we're interested in. We're not as, quite as interested in what you did before as what are you going to do in the next year. So that template, that effort of metrics is part of the larger surveillance, and so we're standing up that function now, and we will probably develop much more sophisticated models of deciding where we're going to go and inspect. And as you probably know, we're working on an agreement with Europe about mutual recognition of inspections and what we'd need to do, and that is also an ambitious project that's on a fast track. We've dedicated some senior staff to working on that, and we have to do a bunch of analyses. And in all this, we're working very closely with the field organization, and they agree with the direction. They have agreed to specialize their inspectorates, and so we will look forward to having a pharmaceutical inspectorate that is pretty much fully dedicated to doing that, as well as bioanalytical people and so forth, so the whole range will be specialized. Now, for all this to work, we're going to have a quality management system as well as you all, okay? Because we can't be giving random or inconsistent advice or, you know, regulatory actions to the regulated and expect them to understand and, you know, respond appropriately. So we're also setting up a policy function, a formal policy function, and we're going to move toward our quality management system. We're pretty far away. I've been working on this since 2002, I think. But the government doesn't have the kind of resources that can be marshaled by a company, you know, just to do this. And so I think most components of CDER now have SOPs and are governed by processes and procedures, okay? But they don't have very good written policies, and they don't have that body of policy work, and then they don't do the most crucial thing, which is audit and assess against their own policies. So we're setting this up now as well, and we will be establishing our policies and then assessing both in the review what deficiencies we send you, as well as inspection, what we find as, quote, violations or whatever. We will be auditing these to make sure and to try to move toward some kind of coherent policy. And then hopefully when we're getting that stage, which is sort of the repeatable stage, and we have, just to be fair, we've audited ourselves several times, and we haven't done very well, okay? So we need to move beyond repeatable up to continuous improvement and getting up to a better place. And I expect that won't occur. I mean, that will occur over the next 2 years. We'll keep working on that. In addition, we're going to have centralized project management very soon. Our pharmaceutical platform includes the workflow management piece as well, so that everything is seamless. And that's going to be run by our central project management. So I think that will create a more organized and structured response, and also a way you can easily find out what's going on. Now, I don't want to leave out my one of my dearly held hobby horses, which is advanced manufacturing. All right, so we're going to set up a team to deal with really advanced manufacturing, so that you have go-to people. If you want to establish some advanced technology, you can talk to that team. They will help shepherd it through the regulatory process. Including continuous processing, using statistical process control, and things like that. And we recognize, and I think a number of you in the room have submitted breakthrough therapy drugs that have received that designation to us. We also have special procedures, because I think manufacturing is going to become the rate-limiting step sometimes for some of these very effective drugs, and we will help you in any way we can to get up to commercial manufacturing so that those can be made available to the patient. So I'm going to press for rapid evolution in the next 2 years. I'm taking personal responsibility for this, and it's it's a very large change, but I think we have a team within the center and the agency that is committed to getting these changes done. But they will only be really successful to the extent they incentivize industry to stay on the course of its own quality journey and don't get in the way of that quality journal. And in getting a strong and enduring culture of quality throughout the industry and a tradition. And we hope to match you there with our own culture of quality that we have. So stay tuned. You will see more about this over the coming year, and thanks very much for your attention.